Okay, hello children. So again, coming back to my class. So there are certain determinants of the peak bone mass. I have already completed like nutritional status is important, genetic factors are important. The gonadal status I was discussing. Both the ovaries with regard to the estrogen, effect of the estrogen, the levels which declines after the lady attains the menopause. And even in males, testosterone does govern. Of course, testosterone throughout the life in male is not such a problem as compared to the females. That's why this problem is to be especially of concern in elderly ladies. And then another most important determinant of the peak bone mass is physical activity. So those individuals who had a good childhood, good teenage period and a good youth with good physical activity, they also tend to have good peak bone mass. So these four important factors, they will actually determine as to whether this individual will suffer from osteoporosis later on in life or not. The other factor which is also important in pathophysiology is bone modeling and remodeling. This word you must have also must be remembering, you must have studied while we discuss about the stages of fracture healing. So modeling, what modeling means, during growth skeleton keeps on increasing in size by adding on the new bone on the surface of the cortex. Okay, so this is modeling. And there is another thing which is remodeling. Remodeling is a cellular process of bone by which both the cortex and the cancellous bone are maintained. So the maintenance part is remodeling, while the addition part is the modeling. That we also, that these two particular terms also come in the various stages of fracture healing as well, as you people must be remembering. So if you see osteoporosis, it results from bone loss due to the age related changes in the bone remodeling, as well as the extrinsic factors and intrinsic factors which can exaggerate this process. So I have just enumerated about the peak bone mass. These are certain intrinsic factors like the genetic part, the other factors which are happening inside the body, the hormonal changes or whatsoever, and the extrinsic part like the nutrition part, the physical activity part, okay, that we will keep on seeing again and again. So bone remodeling has two main functions. First is to repair the micro damage within the skeleton to maintain the skeletal strength. Okay, so that is part I told you, that the maintenance part is the remodeling part. And then another role of the remodeling is the calcium storehouse is in the bone. Okay, so bones are the warehouse for the calcium. So to supply calcium to maintain serum calcium levels. You know, calcium is very important for our function of our muscles, for our nerves, for our cardiac activity, our even arterial activity also. So calcium is very important. So you always remember that when calcium is you must be remembering tetany takes place. So certain things which are related to calcium, and the entire which of course is not the topic for today. So the aim is to supply calcium also to maintain serum calcium levels for various body functions. So this is not so important. So we have coming to the classification of the osteoporosis. There are two types of classifications. One was given by Norden. Of course, you may remember this particular person who gave this classification, or you may just remember the two types are. One divides it into generalized and the localized. The other divides it into the primary osteoporosis and the secondary osteoporosis. The primary osteoporosis can be further divided into type 1, which is postmenopausal, which is most common, and type 2, the senile part. Senile can take place in the men as well as in the female. Primary, you can just understand, wherever the word primary comes in medical science, means you don't know actually what is the cause of this. Some hypothesis they try to explain that why this is happening. In secondary osteoporosis, you have some reason behind to explain that this probably is the reason that why osteoporosis is taking place. So coming to the most common form of osteoporosis, that is the postmenopausal osteoporosis or the type 1 osteoporosis. It is caused by the lack of estrogens, which I was always which I have been always highlighting in my talk, that estrogens which gets reduced in the circulation after the menopause are the main reason for the osteoporosis taking place in the females. What estrogen is causing? It is actually causing the increased bone resorption. So throughout the life, just remember, the bone formation is taking place as well as the bone resorption is taking place. It's a dynamic process, okay? But what happens, this balance after the age of 35, I told you, remember, the peak bone mass is attained between 25 to 35. There, at that point of time, the balance is equated, means bone is absorbed also, bone is resorbed also at the same level. But after 35, you will find the bone resorptions become more than the bone bone deposition. Okay, so finally, what is the result of that? The bone mass will reduce. Then another component is the senile osteoporosis. This affects people over 70 years of age, the elderly people. And what has been defined, it's an age-related calcium deficiency. So here what is important is there is decreased bone formation. Okay, what the reasons for both the osteoporosis is different. Okay, the deposition part gets affected in senile osteoporosis, but the resorption part gets increased in postmenopausal osteoporosis. And usually, what is the result? What are the most common sites for the fractures? It is the hip and the vertebral column. Okay, also the wrist also gets fractured. You must be remembering we have Coley's fracture. Okay, which is the fracture of the distal radius. Okay, as far as the secondary osteoporosis is concerned, you can see there are so many causes. Okay, they fall in six main categories. One are endocrine causes or metabolic causes. Number two are collagen or the genetic disorders. Number three, some medications. Medication also can cause osteoporosis. Then nutritional part, the nutritional deficiency. Then malignancy or hematological disorders and the miscellaneous medical conditions. Okay, you can note down this table actually, or you can take a picture out of it, because it gives a wholesome, it gives the entire list of the most of important list of the causes for the secondary osteoporosis. Most importantly, just remember, we have hyperthyroidism, okay, not the hypothyroidism. If you see in the number one column, you will find the hypothyroidism, the second last, okay? So this becomes very important, not the hypo. Why hyper? Because hyper is associated with the increased metabolic activity. So here it will lead to osteoporosis. This is not the true case with hypothyroidism, okay? Other important common thing which you should remember is diabetes mellitus, okay? And then amenorrhea. Sometimes the ladies in the athletes, they tend to have amenorrhea, which we call as athletic amenorrhea during the young age. So there they will develop osteoporosis. Okay, so certain things, medication part also becomes important, especially the people who are taking, the patients like for asthma or some kind of disorders like rheumatoid arthritis. They are being prescribed systemic glucocorticoids. So if they have been taking this glucocorticoid therapy for more than 3 months, they are more susceptible to develop the osteoporosis. Then PPIs, remember, PPIs are being prescribed left and right. So they can also be the cause of osteoporosis if they are used for long. Okay, then you know that we have anti-epileptic agents like the phenobarbitone, like the phenytoin. Okay, and even carbamazepine, it can also cause osteoporosis. Nutritional part, remember, the patients, they might be having vitamin D deficiency. or they might be having some eating disorder. They are not taking, they are not eating food. Okay, like for example, anorexia nervosa. This one condition where the individual don't like to eat food, and because they, it, it, at one point of time, it was very common disorder in females. They wanted to be slim, and that's why they were not eating like the, what they should take in diet. The calcium deficiency, and those who are alcoholics, if they are taking more than 2 drinks per day, they are also prone to develop this particular condition later on in life. Then remember in malignancies, especially the multiple myeloma, this is one of the most common malignancy in affecting the bone. Then remember certain disorders like chronic renal failure, the chronic liver disease. Okay, so these are certain important things which you should remember, and even not to rule out the history of taking the use of tobacco, which is very prevalent again in the in our country. Now coming to the clinical features, remember that this is a silent disease. It does not cause any problem to that extent, okay, unless the person will come to you with the fracture. Okay, so this will remain asymptomatic. Patient is will be carrying out his or her daily activities like a normal person. The certain features might be there, certain complaints might be there, like they may complain loss of height. Why it is there? Because the vertebra, they get compressed. Okay, so the height might get, they may notice that with time their height is getting reduced, or they are developing some kind of humping of the back. Okay, we call it as a sometimes we call it as widower's hump in ladies, elderly ladies, or we call it as a buffalo's hump or a dowager's back. Okay, so these are certain things. So it's literally nothing, these are just fancy words, but actually it is the kyphosis which they are developing. Okay, or they can have just low backache. Usually the backache in osteoporosis is usually mild, unless a fracture has taken place. Okay, in vertebra and hip, suppose vertebral fracture has taken place because of compression of the weak bone, then these patients will have a acute pain, otherwise they tend to have a low backache. There are certain risk factors which I have already enumerated to you, which you can remember. Hypogonadism is also one important factor which I told you. Testosterone is not a problem with regard to in males, that's why this problem is less common in males, but if hypogonadism is there, of course they tend to develop more chances of osteoporosis. Like smoking is another important thing which you should remember. Okay, rest I have already covered up in almost the etiology part of secondary osteoporosis. So there are certain risk factors which are important to note. Age, if it is more than 70, is considered as risk factor. They are very high risk people to develop to have osteoporosis. And the ladies who have developed menopause less than 45 years of age, they also tend to have osteoporosis early. So of course this is not important for you. As far as the differential diagnosis is concerned, we can have certain things to be ruled out, like hyperparathyroidism, like the Paget's disease, osteomalacia, osteogenesis imperfecta, multiple myeloma, and secondary tumors. Of course, you may find osteoporosis, all the secondary causes of osteoporosis, they may come in differential diagnosis. You may need to rule them out based on the presentation of the patient. Now coming to the diagnosis, of course, as far as the workup of these patients is concerned, most important in any clinical diagnosis is the examination part, the history part. Okay, so you are focusing whether the causes of secondary osteoporosis have been ruled out or not. You do perform blood count, you take the blood urea, nitrogen, total calcium, phosphate, the albumin, the protein part, and the liver function test. Okay, the kidney function test. Okay, you have to do the serum 25 hydroxy vitamin D levels, the parathyroid hormone, the thyroid, total thyroid profile. You might have to test the 24 hour urine for calcium. Okay, then even testosterone in case if it is men, the patient is a male person. Or you have to even analyze in a amenorrheic women the various hormones like FSH, the LH, the prolactin and estrogen. And you are assessing, of course, the renal function and excretion of the calcium and phosphate in the urine. As far as the imaging is concerned, which is an important part of orthopedics, without considering the radiology, our clinical assessment will not be completed. So what you find? There you will find the trabecular resorption. If you find the trabeculae are resolved and there is cortex is also resolved, then you can suspect osteoporosis. Then there is, if it is a endosteal resorption, means the resorption taking place from inside of the cortex, then usually we make the diagnosis of senile osteoporosis. But if it is a subperiosteal type of resorption, means outside, then we make a diagnosis of hyperparathyroidism. So these are two important things which can help in diagnosing whether it's a senile osteoporosis or it's a hyperparathyroidism. Also remember that X-rays will not give you any particular idea of diagnosis unless 30-40% of the bone tissue is lost. Okay, so you will find that there will be decrease in the bone density also. Okay, because there is bone mass is reduced, bone density I told you is reduced. So these the X-ray will appear as osteopenia. Okay, in spine what you will find? You will find there will be cortex which will be thinned out, the osteopenia will be there. You will find that there are vertical trabeculae in the vertebra. They get accentuated. Okay, sometimes we call this as pseudo hemangiomatous appearance. Okay, then these vertebra, they may get compressed. So we call them sometimes as codfish vertebra when they become biconcave, or they become totally flat. We call it as vertebra plana, or silver dollar vertebra, or a pancake vertebra. These are certain names which have been given to such type of findings in case of spine. So these are certain things you can see. There is, if you see one figure on the right side, the middle vertebra, you see there is wedging. This is called as the wedging of the vertebra. Okay, no need to focus on this classification. I have just wanted to show you the picture. You see how the bone is looking osteopenic. Okay, the cortex become pencil like thinned. Okay, you can see the margins of the vertebra. Focus on the right side of your slide. Okay, not no need to go ahead with any other thing. And so this is how the picture on X-ray you may find in such patients. The another diagnosis tool is bone mineral density. So what are the indications for bone mineral density? You usually do in women of 65 years or old and men more than 70 years or old. And in postmenopausal women and men, it is considered like between 40 to 70, you can advise the BMD based on if there are risk factors which are present. While the other third criteria is in a postmenopausal women and men which are above 50 and older, who have had an adult age fracture, means if there is history of fracture is there, okay, then you may consider that even at age of 50 you may like to do BMD testing. Okay, so where you test this BMD? You, once you will be posted for internship in the hospital going around, you will find that BMD is done in our radiology department, and the BMD assessment is done at the level of the spine, the hip, the calcaneum and the wrist. Okay, so that these are the sites where the DEXA scanning is done. Okay, we call this DEXA as a central DEXA. Okay, it is called as dual energy X-ray absorptiometry. That is the full form of DEXA, and it is called as central DEXA. Then there is peripheral DEXA also, means there the density is assessed at the level of the forearm and the calcaneum. Okay, so there are certain contraindications for, because it's a use of radiation, so you will, it's contraindicated in pregnancy or those who have history of recent administration of the contrast agent or nuclear or any other scan. And if there is some radiopaque implant is there in that area where you want to assess, the sites which I have just highlighted, and those who are markedly obese, because the penetration will be defective and therefore the exact picture may not be clearly known. So that's a relative contraindication. Then another tool is called as the, you can just remember, it's a FREX scoring tool, fracture assessment scoring tool. This actually, just highlight on the bottom of the slide, the result of this actually indicates the chances of developing fracture in the next 10 years. So that actually is indicated by the World Health Organization FREX scoring tool, which is also commonly used while the diagnosis of osteoporosis is made in these patients and the subsequent management is planned. So this is how the FREX questionnaire looks like. Okay, this is this has to be handy with the clinician before he can utilize it. Nobody can remember it. So based on this, the analysis is made, which gives us fair idea that the chances of patient developing this fracture within next 10 years. So accordingly, we divide these individuals in low risk, intermediate risk and high risk, which is not, I think I will not discuss about it for your level. Okay. Now coming to the management part. So we have a non-pharmacological, we can divide it into a non-pharmacological management, the basic therapeutic measures. Then we have a pharmacological management, where we are using anti-resorptive agents and the drugs which stimulate the bone formation, or the drugs which have both the function, they are anti-resorptive also, or those are stimulating bone formation also. So first, coming to the non-pharmacological agents, for these patients nutrition is very important, lifestyle modification is very important, like they, you should be helping them to prevent the falls. Okay, taking care of giving them some kind of a support in their hand, or removing any kind of slippery material on the inside the home where they are usually residing or using, that environment needs to be modified. There is a concept of hip protectors also these days, which is the latest development in the kitty. There are sensors which are there, which are made by a person wears, just like if you see the airbags in which gets inflated in case of accident in the car, there are hip protectors are there which have been developed. So once the individual has the tendency to fall or falls, these sensors, they detect it and they get inflated. And sometimes there are protectors itself, like they remain giving some support while the individual falls. So both types are available. Then we have basic therapeutic measures, like where we give vitamin D and calcium, and sometimes in ladies we might have to consider the use of estrogen and the hormone replacement therapy. With regard to pharmacotherapy is concerned, we have anti-resorptive agents which include the calcitonin, the bisphosphonates, the SERMs. What are SERMs? They are selective estrogen receptor modulators. Okay. Then the last in the kitty in this is denosumab. Okay, so this has been recently approved by FDA and it is being used for osteoporosis. Of course, not in our country as of now. Drugs which stimulate bone formation are sodium fluoride, and we have exogenous PTH, the parathyroid hormone, and we have vitamin D analogs. There is a single drug which is strontium renylate. This has got both action as an anti-resorptive agent as well as stimulating the bone formation. So of course, in Britain this is being used. US FDA has not approved it. In India also it is not available. So for that matter, just to complete the list, what we have available with us. With regard to diet, you know, we have to give them calcium and vitamin D rich diet. Remember the calcium contributors, they are dairy products like milk, yogurt, cheese. The patient, you remember these, you may take them very simple, but the patient will ask you, doctor, tell me which calcium products I need to take. That you need, you should be in a position to explain that these are ones which will help you. The ice cream, the cottage cheese, and fortified orange juice, or the certain soya products. most, remember, you must be knowing by this time, vitamin D comes, it's a sunshine vitamin. It vitamin D is most of the time is available through the exposure from sunlight, is available within our body itself. But there are vitamin D contributors also, like fatty fish, and there are few foods also which also can provide that kind of supplement. Then we have lifestyle modifications like adequate sun exposure, avoid smoking, alcohol, and high caffeine also should be avoided, like coffee intakes. And exercise also very important. They improve the physical strength, bone strength, by 30 to 50%. And of course, it's no, it cannot be a just episodic type of use of exercises. It has to be a lifelong affair. Then of course, we have to have certain strategies to prevent falls. Like suppose an individual is there, elderly person, he might be having low vision, might be hard of hearing. So those issues also needs to be taken care of, because might be contributing in some way to the fall. Okay, and of course the environment in which he is working or he is living, you need to modify so that, like he, like even just simple modifications like preventing the use of slippery floors, or even preventing them to slip on a watery floor. Okay, seeing these things can help a lot if are addressed. I was talking about the hip protectors. So this is how the hip protectors, they are looking like that. They may be just kind of a just like a cushion kind of a thing, or they may be airbag type, but they may get inflated, which I do, which I explained you. Pharmacological, of course, once you are sure with the diagnosis, then you give the calcium, which is given in the doses of 1000 to 1200 milligram per day. That is the recommend doses. Up to 1.5 you can give very safely. People, they always ask that what is doctor, it's a myth, doctor, it will increase in the formation of kidney stones and other problems, which is a common myth in the society. No, only if you give it in excess, then it can lead to kidney stone formation, cardiovascular diseases, and even strokes also. Then vitamin D, I told you. How much vitamin D? The maintenance therapy for vitamin D is 1500 to 2000 international units per day. Okay, and usually the elderly people are given around 1000. So you can remember that between 1000 to 2000 international units per day of the vitamin D can be safely prescribed to the individuals. As far as the bisphosphonates are concerned, you of course you know that they are the anti-resorptive agents. Okay, so most importantly, it is the alendronate. It comes in tablet form, so you are giving it 10 milligram daily tablet, or you may give 70 milligram weekly tablet also. Initially 35 milligram weekly tablet was also used to be given, but that is the usual dose for alendronate. Then we have abandronate as bisphosphonate. It is given as 150 milligram monthly tablet, and there are IV injections also available of 3 milligram, which is given every 3 monthly. Then we have risedronate also. It is given in the doses of 5 milligram daily tablet. Alendronate was 10 milligram. Risedronate is 5 milligram. Similarly, you can remember 70 milligram was alendronate. Here it is 35 milligram weekly tablet. Okay. Or risedronate also comes in a monthly doses form of 150 milligram tablet. Then we have another infusion form of bisphosphonate, that is the zoledronic acid. And this zoledronic acid is given in the dose of 5 milligram infusion over 15 minutes, and this is given every 2 years for the purpose of prevention. Just important is that these tablets should be given on an empty stomach, which probably you might have learnt in pharmacology also, 60 minutes before the breakfast, and the patient should be upright for 1 hour. The idea is to prevent reflux esophagitis, which is a very common complication associated, side effect associated with the use of bisphosphonates. So this is again a repetition of that. So abandonate can be given, zoledronic acid as infusions can be given, or the oral medications can be given. Then we have calcitonin. Calcitonin, it is given in the form of nasal spray. Okay, so it is usually given in the doses of 200 international unit, which is like one puff per day. So that is the use of calcitonin. Those who have the side effects which have been reported with calcitonin, they include rhinitis, epistaxis can take place, allergic reactions can take place. Even some people have reported certain cancers, but more or less it is safe. But it's not the first alternative by choice for the management of osteoporosis. Then hormone replacement therapy. Estrogens are used. They are given with or without progestins. And they are usually found to relieve even symptoms of postmenopausal problems and even vulvovaginal atrophy. This is given in the doses of 0.625 milligram per day. We have the two routes available. One is oral, other is transdermal. Of course, you know that very importantly, the side effects are there of estrogens. The coronary heart disease, strokes, the pulmonary embolism, the deep vein thrombosis, and even breast cancers. So that's why the risks are so much that benefit is like it exceeds the that health benefit ratio. If you see, the estrogens are the difficult drugs to be given to the patients, so better to be avoided. Then we have the use of PTH or the teriparatide. This is given in the dose of 20 microgram daily as subcutaneous injection. Usually it is given for 1.5 to 2 years. Okay, this is also one of the very good therapy which is being used for the treatment of osteoporosis. To avoid the side effects which are associated with estrogens, these SERMs have developed. I told you initially also what are SERMs. These are selective estrogen receptor modulators. The most commonly used amongst this example of that is raloxifene. It is given in the doses of 60 milligram per day. What are the side effects? It can also increase the risk of DVTs, hot flushes, leg cramps. But you see, the various other serious side effects which were associated with estrogens, they are probably not there with SERMs. So it is being preferred over the hormone replacement therapy with the use of estrogens or progesterones. The latest in the kitty, which has been approved by the Food Drug Administration of US, is denosumab. It's a Rankl inhibitor, and the dose is 60 milligram is given for 6 months. Okay, it is given as subcutaneous injection. Okay, of course it is not available, it's costly medication, it's not available for use in an Indian setting. Then, just to complete this list, we have the newer medications which are going to be soon available for the clinicians, is the tissue selective estrogen complex, that is bezidoxifene. That again is a congener of basically a raloxifene, but here it has been found to be more effective. It is still undergoing trials, but maybe in the times to come it might be available. So you may remember this particular thing. So just to complete this list, to tell you that we have calcium, we can use vitamin D, we use bisphosphonate, which we have alendronate, abandronate, risedronate and zoledronic acid. We have SERMs where we use raloxifene, and we have other drugs like calcitonin, parathyroid hormone and denosumab. Some drugs which are not FDA approved, I told you, sodium fluoride, strontium renylate, which is being used by United Kingdoms, but not FDA approved, not by US. There are certain drugs like tivolone and genistine. They are still not being FDA approved, but they are being used by certain countries. As far as the role of orthopedicians is concerned, you see, our role comes when concern is managing the fractures. So the idea is to give them the function back which they have lost, give them the activity back which they have lost because of the fracture, so that like they can be up and about. So and avoiding too much of any such manipulations may be harmful, and you need to give the very subsequent physiotherapy also to strengthen the bones and the muscles. Most importantly, the role comes in vertebral fractures. There are two terms which you should, it's pertinent for you to note. One is vertebroplasty, other is kyphoplasty. What we are doing in vertebroplasty, we are injecting the cement in a bone which is developed fracture. Okay, in the especially the vertebral column. I am talking about vertebral fractures. So vertebroplasty, like we inject cement in that area to strengthen that area which has developed fracture. This helps in controlling the pain also and stabilizes that weak area. It strengthens that weak area. Another is kyphoplasty. What we are doing here is we are injecting the cement and inflating the balloon inside the collapsed vertebra. So what we are doing here is we are trying to strengthen the vertebra also, and we are trying to restore the height also to some extent. Then another important management part for vertebral fractures is like to prevent the collapse. As I told you that these patients, they develop kyphosis. So the idea is to prevent the vertebral collapse or to cause deformity. So how to one can do? We are performing the fixation of these weak areas by using pedicle screws. Okay, this helps to strengthen this area, so prevent the collapse as well as probably chances of this future deformity. Okay, so this is how you see, you can see this example of a osteoporotic bone developing fracture. You see how bad the fracture has taken place. Okay, see the osteopenia of the bone. Okay, you can't see the cortex, the medulla. You can't differentiate really well. Cortex usually is very white. The medulla is usually quite black. But if you see the cortex and medulla in these X-rays, you will find they look almost the same. And so this is a example of a fracture in a osteoporotic bone. So what you have done? What we have done is we have fixed this fracture with a plate. The idea is that this individual has to be back into activity as before as much as possible. Okay, so this is how you have to operate these patients and fix them. You see the other things. This is an elderly person. If you see, this is a knee X-ray, you can make out that the joint space is reduced. Okay, you can see even the patella part. There is a spiking, the beak has formed in the upper pole of the patella. What it is indicating? It is a osteophyte. Okay, so it's a showing, what this X-ray is showing is degenerative osteoarthritis. Okay, means it's a elderly person who has developed this fracture because of osteoporosis. So this is how we go ahead. Thank you for listening.